morning? I hope you guys are getting refreshed. Yes? I hope so. Okay. And that your brains are all clicking this morning. I know you're just like curious, what the heck is that girl going to do today, right? Yeah, well, I'm going to come and bring something to you that God has burned in my heart, right? Now, for those of you that don't really know me, I have been pastoring, believe it or not, for 26 years. I'm 50 something, okay? Let's leave it at that. And for the past 23 years, I have been the co-founder and senior pastor with my husband, Andy, at this church. And Andy is my buddy, my best bud, and we do everything together. You heard him on Tuesday. And as Thora taught, we are the Priscilla and Aquila of the New Testament. We work together in all that we do. Well, in all my years of pastoring, I kept hearing this phrase, and it just kind of resonated inside, and I really have taken it before the Lord and talked to the Lord a lot about it, and just said, you know, Lord, how do I handle this? Because I love people, and I want to have answers. So the phrase that I'm talking about that I hear often, and I look to be able to effectively manage it, help them disciple this idea of people when they say to me, gosh, I just been really dealt bummer cards, right? These cards that were dealt to me in life, they set me up for failure. I just can't do this, God. You know, I can't even do this Christian thing. And so when they come and they pour out their hearts to me about that, and they say, I've just been dealt a really bad hand. You know, it just isn't right just to go, well, if you just went to church, if you just read your Bible, right? If you just prayed some more. Now, all that's true, but we need to be able to communicate to them how. How are you going to do that, right? How can they take those practices and actually make it come alive and they can deal with the cards that have been dealt to them? So this is the thing that's burned on my heart. And in my mission statement here at this church, the backside of that is to help people not only find Christ, but to find the calling that they have, that he has on them, to make the hand that was dealt to them a winning hand. And that's what I want to talk to you about. And I want to lay down a story for you first, so that you can see really what I'm talking about, the type of people that I have encountered that have burned this thing inside of me. Okay? Well, this year, there's a girl, we're going to call her Kathy, okay? And Kathy came to our church from a counselor's recommendation to come here. The counselor happened to be a Christian. She had heard about our church and heard that it was a good place to send people to encounter the power of Christ and to be freed up. So she sent Kathy here. And so Kathy came to our church. Now, our church is a larger church, so, you know, a bigger church, so we have multiple services. So Kathy wasn't even on my radar, right? Until she risk took and came to my 101 class, and it was there that I met her. Now, here's a note that I want to tell you about myself, a little inside track. God has given me, one of the gifts he's given me is the eyes to not only see people, but to perceive what the Holy Spirit is doing in their life, right? My staff teases me often, and my leaders, they say, gosh, it's like you could look in our soul. Of course I cannot. It's just being spiritually sensitive. And so my friend Kathy, she came to this 101 class, and so now she's on my radar, and I can hear the Holy Spirit whispering to me, watch her. Watch her. And so I watched her for months as she would come into our service through those doors on a Saturday, which is the smallest of our services. She would sit in this section over here and she would just not talk to anybody. She'd come late. She'd leave early, right? She didn't want to look you in the eyes when you talked to her. She didn't want to talk to you. She didn't want you to touch. And if you know me, I am such a huggy person, right? And she, you know, nothing, not even a handshake or a fist bump, nothing, right? And I thought, oh, wow, Lord, you've given me a really hard one here, right? You've really given me a hard one. So I was teaching one weekend, and I was teaching about the power of Christ and the freedom that he gives us. And so when I finished teaching, as my practice, I came down forward to talk with people and to pray with people, right? So I go down, and lo and behold, Kathy didn't leave that day. She actually came down front, right? And I'm thinking, yay, something's happened. I thought, can I pray for you? And she looked at me and she said, oh, no. No. Right. She goes, but I have some questions for you about this freedom stuff in Christ. I want to know more about that. I want to know about that. And when she was talking to me, I realized at that time that it's not going to be a quick little prayer, you're healed, you're out of here, right? That it was going to take a long time of walking with her. And that began our journey. I set up an appointment with her, and I have been walking with her and talking with her this whole past year. And as she got to know me, right, and I respected her space needs, as I sat there and I would talk with her, she began to unravel her life. She began to tell me how she was in a home with a single mom who had schizophrenia, who was severely mentally ill and would abuse her, how the state came in and took her away from her family, and how she had to survive in the foster care system. And then she told me about when she went to school that she had some learning difficulties and how that colored, you know, her experience in school and how it was so hard for her. And even to that day, it was hard, and it was hard in her work, right? And as she opened up, she also told me about some of the mistakes that she had made in life, a lot like mine and like yours, that we made really poor choices, and that added to her pain. It added to her pain. And so as she sat there over the months telling me these things and me just listening, not even having permission to pray, but just listening and answering the questions that she had about, if this is a loving God, how could this happen? Can I ever overcome the cards that have been dealt me? Again, you can see how my heart just kind of churned. I was like, oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you that you sent me, Kathy. Thank you, Father. Thank you for what you're going to do in our life. And I've been walking with her for a very long time, a very long time. Now, this is what I'm talking about. When you look at somebody and you go, wow, those cards that were dealt, they're a bummer. They're setting you up for failure here in life, not to be able to move forward. And so I'm going to talk to you today about discipleship. I want to talk to you about a way of doing ministry, a way where you can look at a person like Kathy and that you have an idea about how to go about working with them and the cards that they've been dealt. Or maybe even as I've been telling you about Kathy's story, you start to think, because I believe the Holy Spirit's here. I believe that you're beginning to think about people that you know, people that you care about. They're thinking about, I see that. You are thinking about your spouses. You are thinking about your children. You are thinking about your stepchildren, and you are thinking about your grandchildren. And you look at some of the cards that's been dealt to them, and they are the apple of your eye, and you love them, and you think, yes, I'm so burdened. I'm so concerned about them. What's going to happen to them, right? And so you're here, and you're thinking of those, and And there are some of you, you go, I know Kathy's story all too well, because it is my story, right? And you're sitting there thinking, I wonder where she's going to go with this. Well, here's the deal. I want to show you that you can have a winning hand, whatever's been dealt to you, because I believe we have a God that's bigger than the hand we've been dealt, and I'm going to show you how. Bow your heads with me, and let me just ask the Holy Spirit to even come more. Thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, I ask that you'd come and that you'd wake us up, Father, that you would wake us up for the word that you have. I thank you that you have ordained and you have placed each person in this room today, and that you have taken the weakest of all this in this room, which is myself, and you will display your glory just because that's what you do. You use weak things to show strength. And so, Father, I ask that you would just take over this whole auditorium, that every nook and cranny in this room would come under your power, under your control, Lord Jesus, under your control, and that you would bring up what you want to address today, that those things that we carry within our souls, that we would be able to leave them here today, that we would find answers that only you can provide. So, Holy Spirit, we need you. We desire you. Come right now and fill us up. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah. Amen. All right. The Bible says about us people, right? It says that we are very complex. King David said this in Psalm 139:14. Thank you, Lord, for making me so wonderfully complex, right? We are a complex people. There are a lot of factors that go into making us who we are, right? So when we go to disciple ourselves or other people, we have to take those factors into consideration. It's not like one curriculum fits all, right? Like a dress that fits, we know that, right, girls? It doesn't work. Okay. Well, it's the same with curriculum. One size does not fit all. We have to take into consideration the different dimensions that are out there. We have to come at it with what I call a strategic plan, right? To be able to disciple people and to take care of our own needs. We need to have a thought through plan on how are we going to do that. It's just not going to happen by itself. So again, I'm going to lay down some thoughts for you. Just some thoughts, like a foundation, some things that you can think about and perhaps pull them in to the way you do discipleship, okay? Now, in order to do this, I wanted to be creative. So this is my attempt at being creative. How many of you play poker in here? Oh, I'm in so much trouble. Good grief. Come on, lie. How many of you play poker? Or have you seen poker? Okay. Thank you, Jesus. All right. You know, when I was looking at this, this is not my concept. I watched somebody do something once, and it hit me so hard that I could use some of their stuff, you know, and their ideas, because it hooked into some heart that I had about something. And so I am a novice poker player, a Padawan, if you may, right? Okay, so don't get myself in trouble. All right, so we're going to play poker today. I'm going to use poker as a metaphor for cards that are dealt to you, right? Cards that you have no control, because five-card poker, you are given five cards, and you are not to change them. Right? You have to play the hand that's given to you. And it's much like life. We are given things that we have no control over. We have no control over it at all. It's just kind of given to us, and we are to play that hand that comes our way. For example, right? You didn't choose your parents. You didn't choose when and where you were going to be born. You didn't choose whether you're going to be male or you're going to be female, whether you're going to be Hispanic or black or Asian or white. You didn't choose your culture, right? You didn't get to choose all those things. Those were choices or cards that were dealt to you. So to me, poker, playing a hand of poker, is a lot like having to deal with the cards that you are dealt in life. And so I'm going to use that analogy. And yes, forgive me if that offends you, okay? Write me a letter that I will not read, by the way. But you may write it. It'll make you feel good. It's cathartic, okay? All right, so the Bible talks about some factors that go into making us this complex person, and that's what I'm going to pull up and talk about them. But there's something you need to know, a place I'm going to go with you to show you some things, but I need to lay down some foundation, okay, so that we're all on the same level here, right? First of all of these concepts I'm going to share with you today, all of them, while they weren't your choice to lay them down, life kind of dealt them to you, everything I'm going to lay on this and turn around are going to be marred by sin. You see, we live in a fallen world, and so their sin is prevalent, and it has taken a perfect world that God created and made it imperfect. All right, so there's nothing perfect at all except for the Word of God. Right? So there's nothing perfect at all. The world is broken. And so there's a lot of stuff that's broken around us. For example, the weather is broken. You know, you live on this coast, you know the hurricanes that come through, the tornadoes and some of the earthquakes, right? Well, that's not how God intended his earth to be. It's a broken earth. It's a broken one. And our bodies are not perfect. And I'll tell you, the older I get, the more I'm in touch with that one. They're not perfect. Nothing's perfect. Everything has been marred by sin, and so we need to know that, especially when we're talking about these aspects today. First premise. Second premise is that Jesus Christ sent his son, Jesus, or God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to earth for us, and not just for salvation. He offers us salvation. He offers us a way to get back up to the Father, but he also has come to save you and me from ourselves, okay? From the cards that we have been dealt with. In other words, he not only wants to be your Savior, but he wants to be the leader of your life, okay? So that's the second premise I want to lay down. And then the last, which is very important to me, especially as I age here, right? Is that one day each and every one of us will be held in accountability to how we played the cards that God has laid down before us. We will stand before him and he's going to say, how did you play those cards that you were dealt? Now, he's not going to ask you, did you play Sharon's cards? He's not going to ask you if you played Andy's or anybody else. He's going to say, how did you play your cards that I gave you? That's what he's looking for. And we're going to have to give an answer for that. So you don't have a choice whether to play the cards or not that were given to you. You will have to play them and you will have to give an account for them. The premises that I just laid down are true and they're found in the Word of God. So let's go play some poker together, all right? So the first of these five concepts that I believe that shape people into being who they are, the complex beings that they are, the first one I want to show you is, here it is our chemistry, okay? It's our chemistry. It's the way we're made. It has to do with the chemicals that are inside of our body. It's our DNA. It's our genes. It's the hormones that are inside of you and I. Chemicals are what makes you you. At its most basic biological aspects, the chemicals we have is who we are, right? And so I hope you're tracking with me. They affect you. For example, some of you are born hypersensitive to pain. You know, you feel pain very easily. You remind me of like the princess and the pea, right? And the nursery one where the princess lays and no matter how thick, you know, those bed cushions are, she can still feel that pea, right? She's sensitive to the pain and it's not right or wrong. It is what it is. It's the way she was wired. It's her chemistry. Well, some of you have a high tolerance to pain. You could cut off your arm and not feel it, just keep marching forward. It's the way you're wired up. Some of you were born with low-level energy, and you move really slow, right? And then there's some of us, like moi, and I'm like, oh, yeah, yeah, you know, and you want to just go, 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 and you got like this Tigger mentality in Winnie the Pooh, right? You just want to go, go, go. It's hard for you to stop bouncing. Each and every one of us have a different chemical makeup. We have been wired differently. And the truth be known, because of the sin in our lives and in this world, that we have structural and chemical defects, if you were. They're in our bodies and they cause us problems. For example, some of us wear glasses because our eyesight is weak, right? And so that's not right or wrong, it just is. It just is. And some of us have chemical deficiencies that cause us to be more emotional or more physical or prone to having mental problems in our lives. Here's an example of that. If you have low hormones, like let's say estrogen or testosterone, right? Or if you have low iron, it is going to affect you emotionally. It will affect you mentally and physically. It affects who you are, right? There's nothing wrong with that, by the way. There's nothing wrong with it at all. It just is what it is. It's the way you were wired up. Now, this issue that I'm talking about, I captured a concept when I went looking. I love to shop, by the way. When I went looking for a pair of distressed jeans, right? You know what those are, girls? Yeah, tell your guy. Okay, so they're distressed jeans, and they're very expensive. Right? Very expensive. So I went to get some distressed jeans, and what I noticed was this little tag on the inside that says that these jeans intentionally have, you know, have uniqueness about them. They've been marred. They are specifically been changed to be unique. They're uniquely designed. And I got to thinking, you know, I was looking at that, these jeans that were unique because they had been distressed. You know, they had been intentional flaws being added in. I thought, geez, that's like people. That's just like people, right? We should come with a little tag that says this was intentional, right? That's what I think anyway. So we are custom designed by God to give him glory, to give him glory in the very bodies that we have. We can fulfill the purpose that he has. And least you think, oh, this girl's gone wacko. I read this all the time in the Bible, that God delights in weak things. You know, the apostle Paul, right? He had this thorn in his flesh. Now, we're not really told what it is, right? It could be something physical, but it could have been something mental also. All we know is it caused him a lot of pain. It was hard. It got in his way of doing ministry, right? But this is what Apostle Paul said of that thorn in the flesh. He said that he would find glory in it because in his weakness, his God was showing more and more. Do you see that? That God showed up best in his weakness. And here you go. In Galatians 4:13, this is what Paul says to the Galatians, right, that he went to see in Greece. He says, you remember, right, you guys, that it was because of an illness that I came to you the first time preaching the good news. So God used his illness. He used his thorn, the thorn in his flesh, to actually get him to go to a place so that he would share the good news, that people would experience salvation, they would find freedom and a place home. And I bet you those Galatians, they were happy that Paul had that thorn in the flesh. It made all the difference. Matter of fact, it made eternal difference to them. And so God uses those things. He wires us up because of his great purposes. And we need to recognize that the card of chemistry, of makeup, of your DNA, those things were created by God. He allowed them to happen. Now, the next card I want to show you that helps to determine your identity is this one of connection. Connection. And what I'm talking about here with connection is relationships. Is relationships. Now, here's an important fact you need to know if you don't already know, that your connection with people, especially early on as a child, right, and how you were, the way you made those connections with your parents and your siblings and the world around you, that has great impact on who you become later in life. Just great. I mean, huge impact on your identity. Go and look at all the studies that are out there, and it'll show you that it draws this direct link to how we were interacting and the relationships around us as children to who we become, our self-concept. So that's great if you grew up in a home where you had good, great parents that taught you and worked and you connected well with them. But if you were in a home, let's say you got a card dealt to you, right, where you could not connect for whatever reason, you could not connect. And so research shows us when we cannot connect, it causes us problems in our lives. It causes us not to know who we are, to really have a good sense of our identity, right? And so we're unsure of our purpose and why are we here, God? Now, you probably won't hear that as much from somebody who has a stable home with families that speak positive things and that relationship. But life, again, is marred with sin. And so we have these relationships that are problematic, and they cause problems. At least you think that, well, perhaps connection really isn't that important. Let me remind you about a story, okay, in the New Testament, where Jesus was walking amongst people, and a man came up to him and said to him, what's the meaning of life? What's the most important thing about life? And you remember what he said? He looked at him, he said, it's about love and about relationship. He said, it's about being able to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your, energy. He said, that's what it's about, and it's about loving other people, about loving your neighbor. And so in that statement that Jesus made there, he was saying, hey, life is to be about connecting first with God and then with others, to be in harmony with one's God and to be in harmony with other people. That's the meaning of life. That's what it's all about. And I tell you, you can write that meaning of life. It's about loving and about relationships. That's what it is. And that's worth paying coming to this conference, daggone it, just to get that. Now, again, there are problems in relationships. So there's hurt, there's misunderstanding, there's stress. And the more that these problems filter into one's relationship, then they start getting into this cycle of hurt and they cannot connect, and yet they need to connect. They have a yearning to connect. And so you have this vicious circle where connection doesn't take place, and it imprints and causes them to have a hard time finding God and relating to other people. Okay? Now, the third card I want to show you that really affects how you view the world around you is your circumstances. All right? It's your circumstances. These are things that happen around you and to you. These are the things, the events that happen around you and to you. They're the things that shape your identity that you have today. You and I, we are a product. We are a product of the circumstances that happened in our lives, both good and bad. Both good and bad, they help to, again, to imprint on us. In other words, if you grew up in an affluent home as opposed to an impoverished home, they're going to affect you differently. They're going to imprint on you. If you grew up with an alcoholic family, like a father or a mother, or you were abused, right? All these things imprinted on you. And so they are cards that were dealt you, albeit I don't think it's what the Lord wants, but those circumstances they've imprinted on, they make you who you are today. They are part of who you are. And if you've experienced stuff like lots of failures or rejection, again, those are life circumstances that imprint on you, okay? They make you who you are today. The next one I want to show you is consciousness. Consciousness. Consciousness is simply the way we think. It's the way we talk to ourselves, right? Consciousness is the things that we tell ourselves. It's that small voice that's deep down inside of us that speaks to us. Right? And it tells us things about ourselves. Now, here you go. Those things that it tells us about are usually the amalgamation of all the things that we're experiencing, okay, in our lives. And so you have this person down inside. I call it the little Sharon, and she'll speak up, "Hey," you know, and she's always talking to me. You can't get away from that voice inside of you. You just cannot. You can't. It speaks to us all the time, and so we must address it. You cannot ignore it. And here's what I find out. That little person inside that wants to talk, they don't always have the truth. They're responding mostly to feelings. And so they want to tell you what they perceive as truth. Of course, the Bible says that the heart is deceitful. It lies to even itself, right? So you're the biggest liar to you. That's what that says. So you have these voices inside, and they might tell you like stuff like, "Help me, Lord. What is it?" Okay. They might say to you stuff like, "You're no good. You're fat. You're lazy. You're never going to amount to anything. You cannot do this. Oh, you're the wrong gender. You're the wrong age. You don't have enough education. Nobody's going to listen to you." And so these little voices, they come up, right? And they tell you things based on the cards that are dealt to you. And we need to know that. And in Proverbs 23:7, it says, "As a man thinks in his heart," what? "So he is," right? And then it says, "Be careful what you think, because your thoughts run your life," in Proverbs 4:23. And so it has this huge spotlight, and Brian talked about it last night, that it comes and it draws a light as to who and how we talk to ourselves. How are we responding to the inner voice that we have? Now, that voice will direct your life. It is part of the cards that are dealt to you, and it does direct your life. Now, here you go. Least you be bummed out, right? We've got these cards that are being dealt to us, and it almost feels unfair for some people. Some people are, you're like, "Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. I had a good life," right? So you're not worried about where I'm going. But if you're like me, some of these were a bummer. So the Lord wanted to make sure, can't go there yet. The Lord wanted to make sure that he gave us this last card here. It's called choice. Now, this is a great card. This speaks about us making choices. You see, unlike anything that has ever been out there are no angels, no animals, nothing has choice, moral choice, right? Not like us humans. Why? Because we're made in the image of God. And so he's given us choice. And so this is going to matter now because this is going to become a wild card for you. It's going to become a wild card for you. The freedom of choice, by the way, is both a blessing and a curse. It's a blessing because it changes things. It's a curse because we have this tendency to take our choices and do stupid stuff with it, right? To do things that would hurt ourselves and other people. And so it can be a blessing or it can be a curse depending on what you do. Now, here you go. Here's what I love about this card. I love this card because when we exercise truth in this card and choose wisely, what happens is, like with our chemistry, we have truth that overrides it, and this is a wild card, so it can change the way this appears, right? So let's say you have a, you know, you've got some issues going on. They don't have to rule your life, right? God will give you choice to be able to choose that and to change the way it looks and also the number it has, the power it has. He will use it if you choose to let him use it. Connections. If you choose God's way, right, over our connections, then you can walk in forgiveness. You can learn how to connect with people. God can use the very thing that you thought, oh, I'm never going to be able to do this, you know, in relationship with other people. He said, yes, I can make it deeper. And then this right here, the circumstances. Some of you have had some really, really tough circumstances, and you think it's going to define who you are. And God says, no. I want to take this choice and I want to overlay it and I want to change its number. I want to change what it looks like. And the same with your consciousness. I want you to choose to spend time in the Word of God. I want you to choose to memorize my Word. And by choice, you will change this card. Now, that sounds good. How does it work exactly, Sharon? Well, let's come back here to chemistry. I'm going to use my life example, right? Now, I could have chose a lot of things to talk with you today about, but I chose to be able to expose myself to you, okay? And so I'm going to talk to you about chemistry. Chemistry. I have been born with a learning disability and an ADHD problem, okay? Let me tell you what that means. A learning disability means that my brain doesn't function the way everybody else. Now you're all going, yeah, we get it. That's why she's like she is. Well, my brain just doesn't. It doesn't process the information the way, let's say, somebody else, a normal brain would, right? And so how it manifests itself to me was, especially in school, it manifests itself. I had a hard time reading and writing, right? And, you know, so that gave me a lot of angst in my life. And then also the ADHD, that was more of a problem than the learning disability. Why? Because I couldn't sit still. I couldn't stay focused, you know? It was like I had this live wire that was running through me and I had to be constantly busy doing stuff. And in my day and in my age, we did not have medication. My poor mom. We did not have it, right? And so that's part of my chemistry. That's part of how I was wired up, right? And so I thought, oh, I'm saddled with this. And even when I asked God, would you heal me? He said, no. I went to him, I said, God, I know you heal, because I had experienced a healing of a leg injury that I had. So when I figured out he could heal, what do you think I asked him for? Heal me. I want healing, right? I didn't want to have that. That's hard. So in my quiet time praying, he said, no, Sharon, I'll show up best in your weakness. This is how I've made you. Whoa. Really? Yes. Yes and yes. You see, what I have learned is that my Father shows up best in my weakness, and I am going to glorify him in the fact that I am imperfect and that I have sin and I have, you know, that decay of a sinful life that I chose and I didn't choose, and it's all marred, but I love Jesus and I trust him. And so when he said, no, I want to show up in your weakness, I want to overtake that, I said, okay, as hard as that is, oh God, I choose you. Use whatever you want to. And so what he did is he took my learning disability. He took my ADHD. He took those, and what he has done is he put them together, and I am off the charts aware of my own self and of my social surroundings, which makes me good with people. Do you see that? And as I yielded to him, he shows me, and all of a sudden, my choice now, what that does is it flips around and he changes the cards that were dealt to me. He changed my cards that were dealt to me. Can you believe that? You know? And so now I have victory. And there are some of you guys that are sitting in here and you're thinking, yeah, but that's the learning experience, but I have depression. Or, you know, I've got chronic fatigue. I've got anger issues. I've got, and it doesn't matter what you got. Because if you use your choice card and you place it over the chemistry, how you're wired up, God said he will use it for his glory, but you have to choose to allow him to imprint it, for him to reveal the card that he wants you to play with your life he has given you. Okay, so then we come over here to connections. In my life, I was one of the oldest of five kids in a military family, and my father was in the Air Force, which meant for us, back way when, that every 2 years, we moved to not just another state, oh no, to a different country, right? And so we moved all the time. So I learned how to make friends really fast. But then they left, so I have now a hard time letting people really come in close, right? Because of the connections or the lack of those connections. At least I didn't, you know, got that solved when my dad retired. He became an alcoholic, right? Which I don't even need to tell you what that does to you and your trust level. So that connection was marred for me. And then when I chose to ask God to come over and to teach me how to use those things that had happened to me, to talk to me about my connections and how they could get better, he offered and led me to the foot of the cross for forgiveness for people that are imperfect. And then he showed me that the things in my life would make me flexible, would make me wide open, where I could receive and accept people of all kinds, right? So he's using it. And as I'm choosing to allow him, he has changed that card. He's changed it. He changed its power and he changed its suit. That's what he did for me. He changed my connections with people. They're now under God. Circumstances for me. Now, I don't have to tell you it was tough, right? I don't have to tell you that. You could probably figure that out. I have some memories that I still have. They don't hurt as much now, but they're there. Some circumstances that I had to endure, especially with my learning difficulties. Like when I was in the fifth grade, 11 years old, I was very impressionable, right? Well, we had been at this new base, and the teacher there loved to do everything orally. Okay, so she would have us stand up in our classrooms and recite or say how to spell a word, right? And so she would go down, and if you missed it, you'd sit down. Well, I hated that because I couldn't do sequencing. Every time she came to me, I would go, and I'd start with the back of the letter. The class would laugh, but I would sit down in humiliation. And she liked to read out loud. And so when my dyslexia got a hold of me, it would flip me around, and I couldn't read the stinking words. And I would get frustrated. And then people would laugh. Well, it got so rough that year. I can remember about midway through, I walked outside with all the kids playing, you know, on the playground, and my heart was so crushed. I went over. I just sat. And I was fighting, you will not cry, you will not cry, right? Girls, you know what that's like? Guys, you know what that's like too. Okay, so, you know, I'm fighting for that. And then this lady, I think in her ability, she wanted to comfort me. She came, she put her arm around me, and to this day, I can almost feel it. She puts her arm around me, and she pulls me in close, and she looks at me, and she goes, oh, honey, you're pretty. Don't worry about it. You'll get a husband, and he'll take care of you. You don't need to do that stuff. I'm like, oh, it's my future. You know? Right. At least you think, oh, that's just one event when you're a kid. No. Because when I went to college, I can sit, I can talk, I know what's in my heart, and so I can put out a pretty good game when I talk. I was sitting in this room with a professor at a community college, and we were talking about concepts, philosophy, and stuff. And then he told the class he wants to write a little essay in the class, right? And then so we did. I sat there and I wrote what I thought. And so we handed him in. There wasn't that many in the class. And then he read, you know, he was up there reading them and we were doing some other work. And he walked out of the class and then he came back over and he walked in front of me. He looked at me and he took the paper and he goes, "You wrote this?" I went, "Yeah." He took it and he squinched it up like this. And then he threw it at me. He said, "Get out of my class. You're making fun of me." I'm like, "Yeah." You know, what do, right? Nothing. Circumstances, things that happen to us in our lives, they embed on us. It breeds things that makes you who you are. But it also can cause you great pain and great suffering. When I came to find Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and we revisited these, I had a choice to give him the issues of my life, to give him the circumstances of my life, the things that had happened to me. So I chose to let him be Lord of my life. And he has begun to reframe circumstances. And he is saying, "Follow me all the time. Follow me." Like the first big "follow me" for new circumstances was he took me right back into graduate school to go to school to become a teacher, a special educator. I'm like, "Really? I hate school. It was like a punishment, right? You're sending me back to where?" But God said, "Yes, follow me." And I said, "Okay, I'm scared, but I'm going to trust you. I'm going to follow you." And I'll be daggone, as I chose to follow him, made that choice to trust him, I don't know what happened, but he gave me this, just this incredible favor. Incredible favor. And I actually became a professor myself. I actually was teaching teachers how to work with kids who see things differently. Now that God is just, I'm like, "Whoa, look what you're doing." But then he called me again. He said once in a conference when I was with him and walking with him, you know, I was like, "Oh, I love you, Jesus," just like what we've been doing here. And there was a song that came on. It said, would you allow me to break your heart for what breaks my heart?" And I thought, "Ooh, that's that voice speaking. That's God." And so I said, "Sure, God, I guess it'll be okay." Well, my gosh, never did I dream that he would break my heart for people that were lost. In my community, I could see them all up and down the coast. And my heart just bled for them. And I seen the injustice of them not knowing Jesus Christ and going to, you know, an eternity that had no hope. And it burned so deep inside of me that I had to answer it. And I can remember arguing with the Lord and saying, "But remember, I'm a girl." You know, "Remember, I have a learning disability. Remember." And I was pulling out all my weaknesses, all my stops. And God said, "No, follow me. Follow me." I chose to follow him. I chose to follow him in those circumstances, even though I didn't understand. And then there was the time that I chose to follow God when I felt like my whole world was caving in. You know, when I married this handsome man, Andy Mead, you know how girls, well, guys, you too. I don't know why I'm talking to the girls this morning. You know how you get this idea that life is going to be perfect, right? Okay, so I married Andy, and he's a great man. He really is. And then we started to try to have children, and we could not. 5 years. And I would cry, "Lord." And I was on staff as a children's pastor, right? And a youth pastor. And I could love all these kids, but you wouldn't give me any of my own. And it was such a hard journey. And then when I started to work with doctors who were trying to help me, I became pregnant, not once, not twice, 3 times. And each time I lost the child in a later part of my pregnancy, right? And so now I'm experiencing death as well. And so it was so hard. I was so crushed. I was like, "I don't know if I can do this one more time." But I thought, "Yes, God," I felt God said, "go for it." And so I got pregnant again. This time, as we were going, it was the second trimester that they did the ultrasound, and they informed me that this child that I was carrying had problems, and so they wanted to do an amnio. And so I was like, "Okay," and Andy and I grabbed hold, and I thought, "Oh, God, I don't think I can do this again. I think I'm going to not be able to make it if this happens. And so they came in and they did the amnio. And while I was laying on the table waiting the results, I felt my father said, you are to name this child Samuel, asked of God. Amen. Asked of God. And so that's what I spoke. I said, okay, God, I asked you for this child, Samuel, right? Of course, the doctors come in and they say to me, you're in trouble. You're in trouble. This child, has got some issues. And so they sent me to the specialist and stuff. They looked, and what happened was little Samuel's lungs were diseased. And so they were pushing against his heart and pushing his heart out of place. And so he wasn't able to drink the amniotic fluid. He wasn't able to process properly. And so the prognosis came in, you need to abort this child in my second trimester. And I said, I will not. I will not. And I can remember in my third trimester when his heartbeat was going down, and every day I had to listen to the heartbeat. Every day he was dying. And I sat in the back of my yard. I cried out to the Lord. I looked up and I said, I hate you, God. How could you do this to me? How could you allow me to have this circumstance in my life? I'm going to end up in a mental institution. You know, I'm going to go insane. I cannot deliver this child dead. I just can't. I can't. And so I cried out to the Lord and I heard, you must trust me. You must choose to trust me. I was all by myself in the backyard, got up, dried my tears. I went inside and I said, the Lord gives and the Lord takes. Blessed be the name of the Lord. It doesn't matter anymore what you do. There's a reality inside of me because I've walked what I'm talking about. That no matter what God does in our lives, blessed be his name. So I sat there every day praying for my son and counting his heartbeat. And then as we were getting closer, because he was in such distress, this little Jewish doctor says to me, hey, I'm going to send you to California so we can do this surgery to see if we can save little Samuel's life. Because now it's moved along to maybe he could make it outside the womb. And so we had tickets in hand. March of Dimes helped us. We're getting on that plane. I'm going to do whatever I can because I believe this life belongs to the Lord. And so we get ready to get on the plane. I have to have one more ultrasound. I go into my little Jewish doctor, right? His special, his practice. And he does the ultrasound. He goes, huh? And his eyes got really big. And he goes, oh. And so he goes, I'll be right back. And so he runs out, and I looked at Andy, tears, because I'm thinking the child has died, right? And I'm just going, oh, Lord, I trust you. I trust you, right? Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And so as I talked to Andy, I talked to the Heavenly Father. His presence was so real in that room. Well, then here comes my little Jewish doctor, and he's followed by three or four other doctors and the nursing staff, and I've got like 20 people now. You know, it's woohoo, big, naked on the table. I'm like, ah! But all these people run inside, and he's shown them, and then he's like, what's going on? What's going on? And the little Jewish guy goes, I believe it's what you call a miracle. And Andy goes, what do you mean? He goes, look. The heart is moving back. It's actually shifting back to where it's supposed to be. The lungs are actually compressing and going back to what they should be. And by the time Samuel was born, he did not die. He was not really sick, right? He was alive. Yeah, you can go, woohoo! Listen, God takes our circumstances, no matter how bleak they are, and when we choose to trust him, he trumps everything. He changes the cards. He does something magnificent that we never thought was possible to do. Amen. Now I want to talk about this last card here, about our conscience, the way we think, the way we talk to ourselves. When we choose to allow God to imprint on our heart his word, we begin to challenge the very thoughts that we're having about who we are. The very thing that Satan wants to beat up is he wants to touch inside of you and cause you to be uncertain. And God doesn't want that. So he wants you to choose to bend into what he says about you, that you're loved, that he'll never leave you nor forsake you, that he doesn't want you to rely on your own abilities, but to lean into him, and he'll direct you. He's faithful, and he wants to do that for you. And when you trust him and you do that, He changes your reality, and he changes your power. When we have choice and we choose to follow after God, we choose to go after him, not only to make him our Savior, but the leader of our life, then he begins to show you that indeed you are a child of the God Most High. And he begins to show you that reality here on earth. What does that mean? And he takes this choice and he changes it, and you have a royal flush. Nothing else beats it. Nothing else beats it. There's no cards that can be played to beat that. And the Father would want you to know today that the cards that you've been dealt, that if you allow him and you choose to side with him on each one, he will give you a hand that's winning no matter what your card said. Amen. No matter what it says, God says, I want to give you a winning hand. Yeah. Now stand up, and I'm going to close this in prayer. Yeah. Okay. All right. So here's what I want to do. I believe that everybody needs these. This is our journey of sanctification. This is our journey of coming close to the Father. Is it not? Yeah. And so what I want you to do, I'm going to pray for you. But first, I want you to turn the person next to you, and I want you just to lay hands on. If it's your spouse, scoot out a little. Find somebody else. Right? And I want you just to lay hands on them, and I want you to bless them the way God has made them, for the cards that he's dealt them, and that God is moving to make a royal flush out of their lives. So just turn around to whomever. We're just going to take a minute. Lunch is waiting. I know. Okay? Just give me 5 more minutes. You can play quietly behind, and I'll just close this in prayer, and then you can see those people leaving. Okay, go. Switched around. Go ahead and switch around. Okay, just take one more minute. Okay, why don't you bring it to a conclusion? That means amen, if you're unsure. Okay, very good, very good. So here you go. Thank you for doing that for each other. We need that. We need that. So I'm going to have the prayer team. You guys are going to come on down because I believe that there are folks here that as I was talking, some things were coming up. And I'll dismiss the rest of you because I know lunch is very important. Okay? But here's a couple things that I saw. I saw that as you were praying and as I was praying, I saw that the Lord said, I have offended people because I have insinuated that God allows imperfection. And I'm sorry, but that's exactly what I said, right? But he wants to use your imperfection to show his perfection. And so I would like you to be able to come and get prayer about that. Also, I see families. I see children. I see children, and I see parents, and I see you cry out like, holy cow. There's autism. There's learning disability. There's a disorder, attachment disorder. Yes, I see that. I see there's all kinds. There's limbs that aren't forming right. There's behaviors that have cost you such stress. And they're in children and grandchildren. I feel like the Lord says that he's placed you in their lives because you have the key. You have the word of God and you can go and do battle for them. But he wants you to also get some prayer about that. I saw that very clearly. All right? And then for some of you, you know, you heard me talk about babies and you're crushed because there's issues. Come and talk to me. I would personally love to pray with you because I get it. I get it. Okay? I get that. All right, let me bless you. Thank you, Father. Yes, Lord. There is none like you, Lord God. In all the earth, there is none like you. The one true God, the God who does working miracles all the time. The one who takes the cards that were dealt to us by a world marred by sin and sin choices. And you take those cards and you say, if you would only but come close to me, I will change your cards. I will show you who you were meant to be. And so, Father, I thank you for your words today, Lord. I thank you for the metaphor of poker, Lord. I thank you that you choose the simple things to bring your wisdom, to bring your healing. I hear. And so, Father, I ask that those who had ears to hear what you were saying, what your spirit was saying, Lord, that you would imprint that and give them action plans. Give them power to move forward, Lord, to make the needed changes in their lives, to choose you, Lord, over everything, over those feelings, over those emotions, over those connection issues, over the circumstances that have happened to you, even over those voices that talk to you and tell you that you're not loved by Father. He says, oh, yes, you are. You are. And so, Father, I ask for your presence just to push in, Lord, not just for the moment in this message, but the entire time this day, Lord, just continue to love on those people that you brought here. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.